This is your first lecture, lecture number one in our series of cultural anthropology. Today's topic will be, what is anthropology? We are here filming in the new automotive classroom at NCC. It's going to be a very comfortable lecture. Again, these lectures are about half an hour long, and they give you more background to the chapters that you'll be reading on your own. So most of the lecture, again, will be going over important terminology and giving you more relevant case studies as examples to some of the terminology introduced in your book. So today we'll start off with what is anthropology? Based on this first slide, anthropology, my definition of anthropology is the study of humankind in all times and all places. So my definition of anthropology, it's the study of humankind in all times and all places. The textbook definition that's found in your book is, what is anthropology? Well, anthropology is the comparative study of human societies and cultures. It's a discipline of infinite curiosity about human beings. It's so broad that it includes a number of overlapping fields such as sociology, psychology, political science, history, economics, human biology, etc., etc. Again, this is a very long and complicated explanation of what anthropology is, so we'll just use my definition. It's the study of humankind in all times, in all places. The origins, according to your book, the origins of anthropology may have occurred around the 5th century BC with Herodotus. Herodotus was a Greek scholar. Some of his earliest works included a history of Persia. In that history of Persia, he recounts four important Persian kings from Cyrus to Xerxes. He's recording the history of these kings. This is generally considered the beginnings of the study of humankind, or the self-study of human history. All right. Other early examples of anthropological work might include the Bible. In the Bible, it's discussing different various groups that include the Jews, the Egyptians, the Hittites, Babylonians, Romans, Ethiopians, Assyrians. So again, this is an ethnographic work because it's starting to discuss other neighboring groups, those who lived in the Eastern Mediterranean, and groups that had contact, that were considered outsiders, you know, examining the cultures that were around early Christian groups. Then we're still talking about anthropology and how it developed as a field. In the 18th century, during European exploration, with trade and political domination, we see a focus on human differentiation. And this can help us in understanding where anthropology came from early European expansion into new territories. And that included the colonization of the New World, the colonization of Africa, exploration into Asia. And with this, early Europeans were able to discover differences among societies. And this can fall into the trajectory of early anthropological work. But of course, we know that in the early 18th century, Europeans were starting to label certain societies they came in contact with as either savage, barbaric, or civilized. So, and we'll go into greater detail about some of these early anthropologists in our third lecture. But for right now, we're just talking about the trajectory of anthropology. It's not until the late 18th century when Europeans are trying to consider what behavior exists so that they can understand themselves. So it's not until the late 18th century when European thought is now turned to not just looking at the differences between societies, but really how the differences in the behavior of these societies help to identify who we are. And the first academic institution in the United States to create a anthropology department is the University of Rochester in New York. And that department is founded around 1879. Although your book will talk and discuss about how anthropology as a academic track was founded at University of Pennsylvania, I think we're just now quibbling over who was the earliest to offer anthropology as a field of study. I would say probably University of Rochester, Henry Louis Morgan's contributions to the university, although University of Pennsylvania has an equal argument. But that's not something that we need to know for any kind of examination or anything, just for simple facts. The first, again, your book talks about the first PhD granted in anthropology, and I would say it was given out at the at Columbia University in the New School, and that would be Albert Kroeber, but your book is also saying it was probably at, what university was that? I'm going to look into your book here. University of, I'll have to take a pause here. Where is it? Clark University in 1892. But if we look at Clark University, we know that Franz Boas taught at Clark University until he, I'm not sure exactly where the story goes from there, but he leaves Clark University and founds the New School of Anthropology at Columbia University, and his student is Alfred Kroeber. So again, are we quibbling over who the first PhD was in anthropology? Certainly your book says one thing, and you know, my information tells me another, but I would say that certainly the first PhD granted in anthropology in the United States was probably Albert Kroeber from Columbia University. So that again won't be tested on any kind of examination, but giving you an understanding of what anthropology is and how far back it dates, this will help us understand anthropology a little bit better. The fields of anthropology. Anthropology is divided into four subfields. The first division is between biological, physical anthropology, and then cultural anthropology. If this class is the intro to cultural anthropology, we're focused mostly on cultural anthropology, although we will have a lecture, a brief lecture, ever so brief, on biological, physical anthropology. Biological, physical anthropology is, as you can see in this slide, the study of humans as biological organisms. This branch of anthropology focuses and looks at and traces the ancestry of human species in order to understand how, when, and why we became the kind of animal we are today. Biological physical anthropology also studies present-day human variation. We can use blood types, nose shape, susceptibility to disease as predicting the evolution of mankind. And it's important to understand our culture in regards to who and what we are as a biological creature. If biological physical anthropology studies humans as biological organisms, cultural anthropology then studies humans as cultural animals. So again, our first division is between biological physical anthropology and cultural anthropology. And cultural anthropology then, for my definition, is the study of humans as cultural animals. Let me just say that in biological anthropology, we cannot understand what people do unless we know what people are. And we want to know how biology does or does not influence culture, as well as how culture affects biology. So what we're going to do is we'll, in our fifth lecture, we'll talk a little bit, ever so briefly, about biological physical anthropology and what biological physical anthropologists do. I think it's important for us at this time to define what culture is. Your book is going to give you a certain definition of what culture is, and let me give you what my definition of culture is. Culture is often the unconscious standards by which societies or groups of people operate. This is a definition of what culture is. It's often unconscious standards by which societies or groups of people operate. I would also say that culture is behaviors that are learned rather than acquired through biological inheritance. That's something we should think about when you read the book. Is culture biologically inherited, or is it passed down and learned from generation to generation? I would say it's passed down and it's learned. Culture is often based on symbols. Culture is adaptive. Culture has been described as a way of life. We need to also define, and what if we define culture as a way of life for a society, I think it's important for us to define then what a society is. So my definition of society is a set of social relationships among people within a given geographic area, and it also includes your status, your role in a society. So my definition of society is a set of social relationships among a people within a given geographic area. Moving on, we've defined culture, we've defined society. Your book gives you definitions too. Be aware of what their definitions are in case it comes up or appears on examination. Our next division, as you can see, in cultural anthropology is the subfields of ethnology, linguistics, and archaeology. I would consider myself, and I am, an archaeologist. Our next lecture will be discussing some of my research and focuses on the Maya. Most of my archaeological research so far has been in the Maya area. But archaeology is the study of material remains to describe, explain, and reconstruct past cultures. Archaeology, again, then, by my definition, is the study of material remains to describe, explain, and reconstruct past cultures. It's the study of the past. Archaeologists are not necessarily looking for behavior itself, rather the material products of behavior. It's impossible to try to recreate actual behavior. What we do have evidences of is the products of behavior, okay? Such as lithics, ceramics, the trash and debris left from households. That is the product of behavior and not behavior itself. One of the more interesting archaeological projects that we'll be talking about in detail in this class is William Rathje's, who's from the University of Arizona, Garbage Project. I'm introducing it now as an example of archaeology. In 1973, William Rathje excavated dumps in Arizona and in New York. And he found there was a discrepancy between what people were actually saying about their lifestyle and what he was actually observing from the garbage. Some of the interesting discoveries, and this kind of makes it relatable to this class, is that in his questionnaire that he gave out to households, 15% of the respondents of households affirmed consumption of beer. So 15% in Arizona, in Tucson, responded that they were indeed beer consumers. And of that 15%, in a week, no more than 8 beers were drank in a household, all right? When he actually excavated some of the garbage and he quantified the amount of beer cans, and then he quantified that by the number of households in town, he found out that more than 80% of households consumed beer. Not 15%, but 80% of households consumed beer. And 50% of those households drank more than 8 beers a week. So in this example, in this archaeological example, what people actually tell you is different from what actually the behavior that actually is physically present, all right? So other information from this project that we'll elaborate more on the garbage project because it has influenced my research. But in 1973, in Tucson and New York, beef was at an all-time high. We got to remember that economics also played an important role in understanding the past. in 1973, beef was at an all-time high. And what Rafchi was seeing is that a lot of beef was being discarded and thrown away. He couldn't understand why this was happening. Why, you know, like if it's such a precious commodity, you know, food is important. Why it was being thrown out in large deposits. And that is because we were undergoing an economic crisis. People couldn't afford the high price of beef. It was rotting in the stores and it was being tossed away. So again, this gives you a kind of information of what was going on at the time. It has an economic impact, it has a social impact, and we can observe this from archaeological projects. Even contemporary projects that study modern society, our own. We'll elaborate more on the garbage project and its influence in archaeology later, but I wanted to give you this as an example of what archaeologists do. And this is a modern interpretation of archaeological work. We'll certainly focus on my research, which is looking at pre-Columbian, prehistoric cultures in Central America. We'll move on to the next branch of cultural anthropology that we need to discuss and introduce, and that's linguistics. Linguistics is the branch of cultural anthropology that studies human language. We want to know, well, do animals communicate? Well, certainly they communicate. But how is our communication different from other animal species? All right, we have the ability to speak. And humans are not alone in the use of symbolic communication. There are certain other species, like apes, that have not as complex of a symbolic communication system, but certainly we have a very complex form of communication that involves symbolism. What language does allow us to do is to preserve and transmit our culture from one generation to next. That's what language and communication allows us to do, transmit our culture. Inside of linguistics is broken down, as you can read in your book, into descriptive or structural linguistics and social linguistics. Let's define structural descriptive linguistics first. Descriptive or structural linguists look at the description of a language. They want to know the way a sentence is formed or how a verb is conjugated. Social linguistics and those who are social linguists, look at the history of a language, the way that language develops and influences each other over the passage of time. So there's a difference between how language is studied. Those who look at the form and those that look at how language influences society. And that's the difference between descriptive structural linguists and social linguists. Okay. Moving on to our last category of cultural anthropology, and that's ethnology. We're focused mostly in this class on ethnology. Ethnology and ethnologists study human behavior as it can be seen, experienced, and even discussed within those whose culture is to be understood. We'll talk about how ethnologists live among people that they're studying. This is called participant observation. We'll introduce this topic in our third lecture when we talk about Franz Boas. Actually, scratch that. Just got that part. That part's gone. We'll talk about how, in ethnology, people live amongst those that they're studying. This term is called participant observation. We'll define that a little later. Participant observation, we'll define right now, is eating the food, speaking the language, and personally experiencing the habits and customs of a culture and society that's being studied. So participant observation, we'll define right now. Looking at my notes, is eating the food, speaking the language, personally experiencing the habits and customs of the society. That doesn't mean that an ethnographer has to join in a battle to understand the importance of warfare is in a society. It doesn't mean that an ethnographer has to sleep, have sexual relations with those that he's studying to understand the importance of sex. That's not participant observation, okay? What an ethnographer does is give a general overview and doesn't focus much undue emphasis on one part for the expense of another part of a culture, focusing too much on a specific behavior, but more looking at how the behavior influences the culture as a whole. It's important for anthropologists and ethnographers to rely on informants. Your book gives you a description of what an informant is. An informant is somebody that an ethnographer has a close personal relationship and assists the ethnographer of understanding behavior. That is my definition of what an informant is. Lastly, in this lecture, we will talk about the relevance of anthropology as a field of science and its relevancy in academia. So we'll begin. I have 4 points. The first is, it's impossible to account for all human behavior scientifically. Because our actions or our belief are too individualistic and complex, we also need to know that humans are only understandable in otherworldly terms. This is why anthropology is relevant. We need to understand who we are, and it's impossible to do this because we're a very complex creature. So we need to have anthropology to help understand who we are. The second point is, if we're to understand humans, it is essential that we study humans in all times and places, not just contemporary studies, but how we, you know, what our history was, how we got to where we are today from 200 years ago, to understand societies that are no longer with us or cultures that are no longer present. What happened? So to study humankind in all times and all places. That's the importance of anthropology. It helps us to avoid misunderstandings between people. Misunderstandings like this example that I have in the Philippines. Well, I have a personal story, where, and I'm not going to mention any names, but the story goes, while we're having a meal, we were horrifying the local population because we were eating with our left hands and not our right hands in the Philippines. And we came to find out that in this culture, meals are consumed with your right hand. Again, we were using utensils with our left hands and not our right hands. Some of us were left in this group were left-handed. And your left hand was for wiping, for sanitation purposes. So anthropology is important to understand some of the little nuances of a culture. And in this case, directionality was important because it determined your eating and your sanitation hand. And we were unaware of the customs and we were looked at in horror. So again, anthropology helps us to alleviate some of the misunderstandings that we have between societies and cultures, especially in a country like ours that is made up of a multitude of different cultures and groups. Lastly, anthropology is important because it exposes us to other cultures and helps us alleviate some of the misunderstandings that arise between people of different cultural groups. It's really important in our society because we're made up of a number of different cultural groups to kind of be exposed to the other groups, especially if some of you are in the nursing program or the teaching program where you're dealing with a classroom that may include a variety of different cultural groups and societies that are all learning together under or in a hospital where you're going to encounter a number of different people. It's important to know these different cultures so not to offend or to get an idea of why they behave the way that they do. All right. So again, there's a relevancy to anthropology, and you get to enjoy the next month of class with me learning about anthropology and the study of cultural anthropology. So I encourage you then to read the first chapter in Havlin and to use this lecture as a means of understanding some of the terminology a little better for midterms and examinations. And what I will do is in our next lecture, we'll go into greater detail about some of my work as an archaeologist to get, excuse me, that was embarrassing, to give you a better perspective of what archaeology is. All right?